Okay. It's quite a way to start. Well, like Matt said, my name is Rob. I'm going to be preaching here some for the foreseeable future. Ashley and I are going to each of us is going to do about half of this four-part series. So like Ashley said, she's headed to camp this week, and she'll be there next week. So I'll do this week and next week, and then she'll do the following 2 weeks. Just in case you're trying to plan your next couple of weeks, like when do I want to be here and when do I not, I'll be here next week. So if you're like, yeah, we could cook out next week and do something else, that's fine. I get it. You know, no offense taken. All right, so we're starting this series called The Errors Tour, and obviously we're sort of like riffing a little bit on this global phenomenon that is the Taylor Swift Eras Tour. I told somebody last week after the service, I said, yeah, this is what happens when a dad joke makes its way into a planning meeting. And the person I said it to didn't think it was funny. She thought I was like just saying something negative. But the Eras Tour came from, like, this was my idea, so I have to own it. So I have to, like, I'm the dad joke, so that's the joke's on me. So y'all didn't think that was funny either. So, see, here's what I'm doing. 9:30 is when you find out what works and what doesn't. And then the 11 o'clock, you're like, yeah, that didn't work. We're going to try that a different way. So anyway, see if I can pull this out of the ditch. So I'm going to tell you guys a story really quick as we sort of get into what this series is. And I'm going to tell you this story, and I need this to be a safe space. Because the story I'm going to tell you is not a story I'm proud of. It's not a story I like. It's not a story I want you to know. But for the sake of this series, for the sake of the sermon, I have to tell you this story. I have no choice. So I just need to know that as I tell you this story, it's going to be okay. And it's going to go out on the internet, and that's just, I can't do anything about that. But for the moment, I need to feel like, okay, I can tell you this story, and it's going to be fine. So here's what happened. We moved to Edmond back in October. So we lived in our house in Edmond for about a month. And I was going out to, and we'd gotten to the point, we weren't totally boxless yet, if you know what I mean, but we were to the point where we could park cars in the garage, which if you've ever moved, you know, like that's a big moment. And so we started parking our cars in the garage, and I went out into the garage one morning, and I was going to work, like I normally do. And so I go to my car, I open the back seat door, and drop my laptop bag in there, and then I get in the front seat. I had already opened the garage door, and I start backing my car out of the garage, and all of a sudden I hear a giant like crash on top of my car. And I don't know what it is, and I don't know what to do next. What I should have done was get out of the car and find out what it was. What I did instead, and this is the part I need you to not judge me on, I kept backing out. Because I thought, like, whatever it is, maybe it was like a big bird and it'll just like fly away. I don't know why I thought that. And so as I'm backing out, I can hear like a crunching noise, and I think like, well, I should probably stop backing out. And so I get out of the car, and I look up, and I see that the garage door, I'm about halfway out, and the garage door has landed on top of my car, has like come loose and landed on top of my car. And all of a sudden, I'm like, how in the world did this happen? I start getting in my head, I'm like getting mad at the builder. Like the builder just like put in like a faulty garage door or something. And I realize like that I don't know what to do now. And so I decide, and again, maybe not the best choice, but I decide like, I can't just like leave my car like this. So I get back in and I pull the car back into the garage because that was the path of least resistance at that point, I guess, just to see like what, like, well, is the garage door going to fall the rest of the way down? And it didn't, because I had actually dislodged the garage door from its tracking as I backed out. So, in fact, I think we have a photo of what I did to my own garage door. Yeah, we lived in this house for like 3 weeks, and I did that. And so, yeah, Ouch is right. That's how I felt too. So I call an emergency garage door guy, and they were able to come out in within a couple of hours, miraculously. And again, I'm still thinking like, oh, this is the builder's fault. This is like, we just got a bad garage door opener or something like that. And the guy, like a garage door CSI, he's like looking around my garage and he's trying to figure out what happened. And he said, hey, let me ask you something. Did you open and close your back door before you got in the car? And I said, yeah. I said, how did you know that? And he looks, and you know that string that hangs down, like that you can pull on that will like dislodge the garage door in case of emergency? He said, here's what I think happened. I think you slammed the string in your back door and then started backing out, and then you pulled the garage door loose as you were pulling out, and that's why it dislodged. And I'm like putting it all together in my head, and I realized like, this is exactly what happened. There's no way that's not what happened. So this was completely on me. So we could look at this as a series of errors on my part. I can't blame the builder. I can't blame anybody but myself. I did that. So now we've made some, they fixed the garage door, we shortened the string so that that won't ever happen again. But it was completely my fault, and I had no one else to blame but me. And so as I was sort of thinking through, like, okay, how do we start this conversation about the Errors Tour and what we're going to be talking about for the next few weeks, I was thinking about, like, well, everybody's had a moment or two, probably, in their lives where they've made a choice, where they've done something, whether consciously or unconsciously, and then in retrospect thought, like, maybe what that wasn't a great idea. Maybe I should have checked. Maybe I shouldn't have kept backing the car out. Again, a series of errors that I made that led to that moment. And so here's what we're doing with this series. We're going to look at some stories in the Bible. And the stories we're going to look at are stories about people who we generally speak positively about or think positively about as we look through the scriptures. But maybe in the course of whatever is going on, they made a choice or a series of choices that led to some pretty negative outcomes. And we think, like, what in the world were you even thinking when you did that? And then this realization of, like, oh, right, I backed into my own garage door. So, like, I could judge, but then there's also the thing of, like, yeah, but, like, we all sort of have our own backing into the garage door kinds of moments every once in a while. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at some stories about these kinds of things happening. And again, it's easy to judge people in the Bible for making the mistakes that they make. But the more interesting question, probably, I think, would be, am I capable of making the same kinds of errors? Maybe not these exact errors, because a lot of them are, like, era and time specific. But, like, in terms of, is it possible that I can actually learn something from the mistakes that people make in the scriptures? Maybe those stories are in there for a reason too. So we're going to start today by looking at a story, or actually a series of stories, about a guy named Abraham. Earlier in the story, he's called Abram. So you might hear me refer to him as Abraham or Abram. It's the same guy. His name gets changed midway through all the stories. So we're going to start in Genesis chapter 12. Now here's the thing you need to know about Genesis 12. Genesis 12 is the introduction to this person, Abraham. And here's what we know. We know that this is sort of the inauguration of a story of a people, of the people of Israel. Abraham is the prime protagonist, I would argue, the first of the patriarchs in terms of the story of Israel. And so what we find in the story is, oh, this is where the whole thing begins. And as we look at the story of Abraham, what we're finding is this is what the whole movement, this is where the whole story was meant to start. So in Genesis chapter 12, beginning in verse 1, it said, "The Lord had said to Abram, 'Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you.'" So the initial calling here, the whole thing begins with this one person being told, wherever you go, your job is to make things better. All people on earth will be blessed through you. Your purpose in this world is to interact with everybody else as if your job is to bless them. And so Abram is expected to inaugurate a new story that is primarily about a group of people being a blessing to all people on earth. This is the first thing we learn about Abram. Now, I would argue, just sort of as an aside, I would argue that this is a story that the local church has inherited, that we come from a long line of people who are called to be a blessing to others. Our hope, I think, probably, is for the Well or any church that we're a part of to be a blessing to, like, if, when we move into the neighborhood, things should get better. That's the whole idea here of you will go into the world and you will be a blessing. So now, we sort of see a progression of what happens next to Abraham, Abram. So in verse 4, right after this, it says, "So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran." And then if you jump to verse 6, it says, "Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land." And then in verse 8, "From there, he went on toward the hills of east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There, he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord." So there's this pattern beginning to emerge. So the pattern is, because the whole thing begins with leave your father's household and go and be a blessing. So we are connecting this notion of leave your father's household, which is to say travel through, like, a space that doesn't necessarily belong to you or initially belong to you. So leave your father's household and be a blessing are connected. The expectation is, again, wherever Abram goes, that place will be better because he moved into the neighborhood. Wherever you go, be a blessing to the people who live in that place. So then, in verse 10 of chapter 12, we are still in the same chapter where the whole thing is framed around going and being a blessing. So then in verse 10, it says, "Now there was a famine in the land, And Abram went down to Egypt to live there for a while because the famine was severe. As he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife Sarai, who later will become known as Sarah. So again, those names are interchangeable as we talk about it. But he said to his wife Sarai, I know what a beautiful woman you are. To which she says, thank you. Why do you say that right now at this moment? And then, so he goes on and says, when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife. Then they will kill me because, but they will let you live. Say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you. So this is an odd request, I would say, as you're about to like go into a new place. So then in verse 14, it says, when Abram came to Egypt, the Egyptians saw that Sarai was a very beautiful woman. When Pharaoh's officials saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh. Pharaoh, by the way, is another word for, like, he's the king of Egypt. So it says, they praised her to Pharaoh, and she was taken into his palace. He treated Abram well for her sake, and Abram acquired sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, male and female servants, and camels. So they're going into this space, and Abram says to his wife, let's say you're my sister for my sake. And so it works, and Sarah is taken to live with Pharaoh on his, like, compound, I guess, and he goes into, and so he then is rewarded for being Sarah's brother. So now he's getting rich while Sarah is basically completely thrown under the bus. So then in verse 17, it says, but the Lord inflicted serious disease on Pharaoh and his household because of Abram's wife, Sarah. So Pharaoh summoned Abram. What have you done to me? He said, why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister so that I took her to be my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go. Then Pharaoh gave orders about Abram to his men, and they sent him on his way with his wife and everything he had. Abram gets to keep all, like, he committed, like, big time fraud, and he gets to keep every single thing. He's become richer as a result of that. Everybody else is worse off, including his wife Sarai, but he seems to be doing great. Like, he's acquired lots and lots of stuff. So this is a pretty jarring story, by the way, especially if we're just told that this guy's whole job is to go into the world and be a blessing to everybody else. There's a concept in storytelling called saving the cat. I don't know if you're familiar with this term, but basically this means, like, if you're writing a screenplay or a short story or anything like that, and you want the audience to embrace your main character, you want them to do, like, a noble deed. You want them, like, saving the cat. You want them to befriend a small child or, like, again, like, save a helpless animal. You want to do something, you want to have the character do something so that you will be on this character's side. Throwing your wife under the bus and lying about her identity so that you can save your own skin and maybe get rich in the process, not a great way to get us on Abram's side. So the writers of the text are maybe not doing the best job of keeping us, if the whole goal is to make us, like, honor and revere Abram, this is maybe not a great place to start. So now, he's been, like, definitely reprimanded for this. Now, which I would argue this is where the error is. The error is Abram goes into the space, and rather than being a blessing to everybody else, he basically just decides to save his own skin and get rich in the process, and, you know, everybody else can just handle themselves. So then, after this happens, he's seen that this is not a great outcome. I mean, it's worked out pretty well for him, but everybody else, it's not going that great. So I think we can probably look at this story and think, like, surely he won't do this again. Like, this seems like a weird, like, one-off situation. It won't happen again. Not to worry. Let's move on through the scriptures and pretend like this never happened. Jump over to chapter 20 of Genesis. So it says, now Abraham, so his name has now officially been changed. Now Abraham moved on from there into the region of the Negev and lived between Kadesh and Shur. For a while he stayed in Gerar, and there Abraham said to his wife Sarah, she is my sister, or said of his wife Sarah, she is my sister. Then Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent for Sarah and took her. But God came to Abimelech in a dream one night and said to him, you are as good as dead because of the woman you have taken. She is a married woman. Now Abimelech had not gone near her. He said, Lord, will you destroy an innocent nation? Did he not say to me, she is my sister? And didn't she also say he is my brother? I have done this with a clear conscience and clean hands. To which we would say, good point, Abimelech. That's a fair argument. So then in verse 6, it says, then God said to him in the dream, yes, I know you did this with a clear conscience, and so I have kept you from sinning against me. That is why I did not let you touch her. Now return the man's wife, for he is a prophet, to which we would be like, what kind of prophet is this guy anyway? For he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you will live. But if you do not return her, you may be sure that you and all who belong to you will die. Early the next morning, Abimelech summoned all his officials. And when he told them all that had happened, they were very much afraid. Then Abimelech called Abraham in and said, "What have you done to us? How have I wronged you that you have brought us such great guilt upon me and my kingdom? You have done things to me that should never be done." And Abimelech asked Abraham, "What was your reason for doing this?" Abraham replied, "I said to myself, there is surely no fear of God in this place, and they will kill me because of my wife. Besides, she really is, this part blows my mind. Besides, she really is my sister, the daughter of my father, though not of my mother, and she became my wife," which raises lots of questions for the rest of us, but Abraham seems to talk about like, I wasn't lying technically. I just left out some very important other information. And so he says, "So I said to her, this is how you can show your love to me. Everywhere we go, say of me, he is my brother. This is how you show your love to me." Good grief. Okay, so then in verse 14, it says, "Then Abimelech brought sheep and cattle, male and female slaves, and gave them to Abraham, and he returned Sarah, his wife, to him." So Abraham keeps getting richer because of this. And Abimelech said, "My land is before you. Live wherever you like." To Sarah, he said, "I am giving your brother." I love you. I would imagine Abimelech's like, "Brother, I am giving your brother 1,000 shekels of silver. This is to cover the offense against you before all who are with you. You are completely vindicated." Which, by the way, this is the first time in all these stories that anybody talks to Sarah like she's a human being. So then it says, "Then Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female slaves, so that they could have children again. For the Lord had kept all the women in Abimelech's household from conceiving because of Abraham's wife, Sarah." So once again, Abraham does exactly the same thing he did a few chapters earlier. He gets called out on it, and clearly nobody, even God, is not in favor of what Abraham is doing, but he did it again a second time. So now, later on, Abraham and Sarah have a son named Isaac. And I would imagine Isaac probably at some point heard these stories. I can't imagine these stories were kept from him. And I would imagine at a certain point, Isaac said, "Well, I'll never do the thing that my dad did. Like, there's no way I will ever go into a place with my wife and tell somebody that she's my sister. That is outrageous. I can't believe my father did that." Jump with me to Genesis chapter 26. So in verse 21 or verse 1 of Genesis 26, it says, "Now there was a famine in the land besides the previous famine in Abraham's time, and Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar." Does that name sound familiar to you? So then in verse 6, it says, "So Isaac stayed in Gerar. When the men of that place asked him about his wife, he said, 'She is my sister,' because he was afraid to say, 'She is my wife.' He thought, 'The men of this place might kill me on account of Rebekah, because she is beautiful.' When Isaac had been there a long time, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked down from a window and saw Isaac caressing his wife, Rebekah." So Abimelech, which, awkward. And so Abimelech summoned Isaac and said, "She really is your wife. Why did you say she is my sister?" And Abimelech's got to be like, this feels so familiar to me. I cannot place why I'm having deja vu right now. And he says, "Isaac answered him, 'Because I thought I might lose my life on account of her.' Then Abimelech said, 'What is it you have done to us? One of the men might well have slept with your wife, and you would have brought guilt upon us.' So Abimelech gave orders to all the people, 'Anyone who harms this man or his wife shall surely be put to death.'" So this happens three different times, twice with the same king. Like, this story keeps happening over and over and over again with people who are later on designated as like the patriarchs and heroes of the faith. So the question then becomes, what do we do with these stories? Like, obviously you can't look at these stories and say like, these guys made all the right decisions the whole time. So what do you do? Like, this happens over and over and over again. The same, like, this is like if I had backed into my garage door twice and then my son grew up and then backed into the same garage door on his first day of driving. Like, this, how in the world does this keep happening? How in the world does he keep making, these guys keep making the same mistake over and over and over again? What do we do with these stories? So here's what I'm not going to do. I am not going to stand up here and tell you that this is fine. Like, because of who does it, I'm not going to tell, like, Abraham and Isaac are like unimpeachable, like heroes of the faith. We can't touch anything they did. I'm not going to stand up here and do that. I'm not going to tell you that this is okay. I would never do that. So, that is a trend that you do see sometimes. There's one commentator, I will protect his identity, but there is one commentator who writes about the first story that I read, and he writes this. He says, "It must be noted, in Abraham's defense, one, the word sister is sometimes used in the Song of Songs as a euphemism for wife or lover," which is strange. And then it says, "And also, And then he says, and also, too, Sarah really was his half-sister. So, like, he's writing, this commentator is writing, like, look, it's not all bad. I mean, he's not necessarily lying. And if you look at it, like, just this way, then it's probably just fine. I wanted to reach through the pages of the book and, like, grab the guy by the shirt collar and be like, hey, man, that doesn't make it better. This is still a terrible story. What are we supposed to do with this? So, again, what do we do with these stories? Even though we can't ignore this or excuse it, I do think there are things here we can learn from. Again, if you look at errors and you start thinking in terms of like, okay, if we just sort of take a step back and ask like, okay, what led to this and why is this here and what am I supposed to do with it? We actually might be able to learn something from somebody else's repeated mistakes, making the same mistake over and over again. Sometimes seeing someone repeat an error over and over again is a good way of offering up an opportunity for reflection and introspection. So we're gonna look at two dimensions of like, okay, what can we learn here? There are two dimensions worth talking about in these stories. And here's the first one. These stories model what we might call non-dualistic thinking. So here's what I mean by that. We tend to have a habit of seeing things in very black and white terms. Our brains want that. Our brains want to have very even, clean categories. This person is good, this person is bad. This person is right, this person is wrong. This person is smart, this person is not. We like to think in terms of, like, again, a binary, dualistic way of seeing the world. And again, this person is always this, and this person is always that. Genesis 12 kind of throws that into the wind. Genesis 12 begins by telling us that Abram is being set up as the protagonist of this entire narrative. And the people reading and sharing these stories later on would already have very naturally had a pretty high view of both Abraham and Isaac. Because again, like later on in the scriptures, if you find people like claiming their identity as a people, what they will often say is, we are the people of the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. You hear these names thrown around as if they mean something to people. And so these are people who later on would be deeply revered by the people who would share these stories. These stories were preserved by the people who revered these guys the most. So the people reading and sharing these stories would already have had a pretty high view of both Abraham and Isaac. But by the end of Genesis 12, we're having a hard time with this, right? Like, we can't just look at this in black and white terms. On the one hand, we're told this guy is going to go and be a blessing to the rest of the world. And on the other hand, we're told this guy is willing to do some pretty nefarious things in order to save his own life and get rich in the process. So again, the people circulating these stories also would have had a pretty antagonistic view of the two groups of people that they end up interacting with. So in the first story, they're going into Egypt. Later on, the people who are circulating these stories would have had a pretty negative view of the Egyptians because of the entire story that happens in the book of Exodus. So you have that. But then later on after that, you have the people of Israel who are sort of in a constant sort of antagonistic relationship with the Philistines, which is where Abimelech is the king. And so you have these groups of people who revere Abraham and Isaac and have pretty negative overall views of the Egyptians and the Philistines. In these stories, what happens? The whole thing gets flipped upside down. In these stories, the patriarchs, Abraham and Isaac, the so-called heroes of the faith, do the wrong thing, and the kings of these foreign nations that these people don't like end up doing the right thing. There's a writer named Richard Rohr who says this. He writes this. He says, the dualistic mind is essentially binary, either or thinking. It knows by comparison, opposition, and differentiation. It uses descriptive words like good, evil, pretty, ugly, smart, stupid, not realizing there may be 100 degrees between the two ends of each spectrum. Dualistic thinking works well for the sake of simplification and conversation, but not for the sake of truth or the immense subtlety of actual personal experience. Most of us settle for quick and easy answers instead of any deep perception, which we leave to poets, philosophers, and prophets. Yet, depth and breadth of perception should be the primary arena for all authentic religion. How else could we possibly search for God? What's he saying? Sometimes wisdom comes from some pretty unexpected places. Sometimes the people that we put up on a pedestal don't make the choices we wish they would make. And sometimes the people that we've written off because we don't agree with them most of the time have a pretty interesting point. So I remember several years ago, I was preaching at a pretty large church. I was kind of new. I joined, it was a while back now, but I was preaching a sermon And I found it was a sermon on community, and I found a quote by a guy named Chuck Palahniuk. I don't know if you know who this is. He's the guy who wrote the novel Fight Club. And so I had been reading a series of essays by this guy, and he wrote about how when he was writing Fight Club, he ended up having to go to a lot of support groups for people who were terminally ill. And what he writes in this essay, he basically talks about how, like, when I was in these support groups, I found, like, honesty and vulnerability and acceptance in ways I've never seen anywhere else. And this is what he says. He basically says, I wish church was more like this. And I thought, like, that's a powerful quote. I'm going to quote that. And so I used the quote in a sermon, and then this particular church, they had comment cards so people could write their thoughts about the sermon and then leave it for you to get, like a little grenade for you to discover later. I'm very grateful we do not do that here. If you want to give me a negative comment, you got to find me first. So somebody left a really angry negative comment, and it actually ended up being the spouse of somebody else who was on staff at that church. So I thought, like, oh no, I'm in big trouble. Like, I quoted, and her whole thing was, why would you quote this person who is not in agreement with us on these issues or on this, like, theological whatever? And so I felt really bad at first, like, oh no, maybe I shouldn't have quoted this guy. But then the more I thought about it, the more I thought, like, no, he makes a good point in his quote. Just because I don't agree with him on every single thing that he's ever said or written doesn't mean his point in this situation is not valid. And so what the person was modeling in the comment card was dualistic thinking. This person wrote a book that I don't like that was turned into a movie that I liked even less, and now I am mad that I am being reminded about this person's existence, and so I'm going to I'm going to make my position known in a really, like, loud negative way. And so what happens quite often is we assume that just because a person always, or we tend to disagree with a person, that they have nothing to offer to the conversation. And we tend to assume that the person we generally agree with will always be right. And what we find in these stories about Abraham and Isaac is, oh, neither of those things is always true. It turns out things are a lot more interesting than that. Watching someone we respect or admire make an error reminds us, oh, that person is human. And then hearing someone voice a point that we don't normally agree with, and hearing that person say something, and we think, like, oh, that is actually a valid thing that you just said. Like, oh, the whole thing, it's a lot fuzzier than we tend to give it credit for. So the question these stories leave us with is, are there ways that I have fallen into dualistic thinking? Are there points of view that I have written off because I just assume that they're always wrong because they're wrong about this other thing that I tend to think? Are there people who I have designated as my enemy? And if I really think about it, it turns out we have more in common than we realized. We tend to see things in very black and white points of view, and these stories, it's like the writers of scripture are begging us, do not do that. Like, the Bible does not do that. The Bible does not give us black and white dualistic thinking. It reminds us, oh, these people are human. These people have the capacity for doing really great things, but they also have the capacity to do very harmful things. And we have to sort of live inside the tension that both of those things are true. So that's the first sort of dimension that we can look at here. The second is this. These stories invite us into a conversation about what it means to be a blessing to others. Because again, the whole thing begins with God telling Abraham, you will go into the world and you will be a blessing to everybody else. And so we see Abraham go into these spaces and we see him do very well, but everybody else suffers as a result. So we have to ask the question, is this what we mean? Is this what God means when God says, you will go and be a blessing? Or does Abraham lose the plot in service of saving his own skin? And so Abraham is meant to go into the world, again, and be a blessing. But does it count as a blessing if only he benefits and everybody else suffers? So Abraham and Isaac are both successful. They both receive things that people in that time would have thought of as good things to have. But they still fail to do the thing that they were actually supposed to do because their actions cause lots and lots of pain for others. Now, what's interesting, if you jump back over into the earlier story, right after the story about the first one, where Abraham goes into Egypt and lies, that's at the end of chapter 12. Now, at the beginning of chapter 13, this is what happens. It says, so Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Abram became very wealthy in the livestock and silver and gold. And then if you jump down to verse 5, it says, now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. And quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at the time. So Abram said to Lot, let's not have any quarrels between you and me, or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. is not the whole land before you. Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. And if you go to the right, I'll go to the left. What is he modeling here? He's modeling a kind of, almost a selfless kind of behavior, which is kind of jarring considering the story that we just saw. So Abram is capable of doing something that is generous and open-hearted and good for somebody else before, like over and above himself. In fact, there are rabbinic commentaries about this part of the story that suggest that Abram actually muzzled his own flocks whenever they might overgraze the land that belonged to other people. Like, Abram exhibits the ability to be deeply considerate and aware of the needs of others. So both things are true. So what is the difference between the Abraham that we see here and the one that we see one chapter earlier? What is Abraham's primary emotion in chapter 12 and then later in chapter 20 and then Isaac's primary emotion in chapter 26? Fear, right? Every time it starts with, I'm afraid if we go into this space and people know that you're my wife, I might be in danger. So Abram's fear drives his inability to be a blessing to anybody else. If there is one thing that makes us unable to offer grace and peace and love and hospitality to other people, it's fear. Fear points us inward. Fear dictates that we see everybody else as a threat and only ourselves as someone worth saving. But look at what it says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. This writer says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. So we have these three echoing stories, and they all seem to be grappling with questions about what it means to be a blessing to others. But the thing that throws a wrench in it every single time is that the main person who's meant to be a blessing to somebody else begins to feel fear. And that fear creates a wedge between Isaac or Abraham and everybody else that they could be offering grace and peace and love to. Fear gets in the way of us being a blessing to everybody else. If I am only interested in my own safety and comfort and preferences, then it's very hard for me to be a blessing to somebody else. If I subscribe to a black and white view of the world, to this dualistic thinking that this group of people is right and this group of people is wrong, if I begin to see the whole world like that, it's very difficult for me to be a blessing to anybody that I haven't already sort of sanctioned in my mind. If I live with a heightened sense of fear, I cannot be a blessing to others. So we're left with these questions. Do I see the world through these black and white dualistic lenses? And in what ways do I need to kind of shake that off and begin to sort of see a new way of seeing things? And in what ways have I allowed my fear of other people, of other groups of people, of possible outcomes, in what ways have I allowed that to prevent me from offering grace and peace to somebody else? We look at the errors of other people and we begin to say, like, oh, I'm in that story. It's not that this kind of thing happened, it's that this kind of thing happens all the time. Fear prevents us from showing love and grace to others, from being a blessing in the world. Are there ways that you could offer something good to the people around you, but there is fear standing in your way? May we allow ourselves to see the world through a much more interesting pair of lenses. May we shake off the dualistic way of seeing things, and may we not allow fear to drive us away from being a blessing to the people around us. Let me pray for us. God, we thank you for these stories. We thank you that we are reminded that the whole thing is not anywhere near as simple as we want to think it is. And as we wrestle with these, as we consider what these stories have to do with anything, may we begin to see the world in new kinds of ways. And may we stop allowing fear to prevent us from being a blessing to the people around us. May we not repeat the errors of the past. And may we bring something better and more beautiful into the world instead. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.